Background music and ambience brought to you in part by Midnight Syndicate. Music for the imagination and the perfect musical accompaniment for the Dungeons & Dragons role-playing game.
The leader of Gagmi is dead. The guild as a whole has been dealt a critical blow. The world trembles as portal magic tears at the fabric of reality. Tim and Terry must find the Stable One in order to end the threat from the other realms. And Master Duché has finally acquired the means to conquer and rule this realm as a god. Now, prepare yourselves for the culmination of Campaign 1 as they seek resolution of a fool's quest.
Great.
Okay.
All right, where last you left off, you had arrived at the Amache Desert, talked to some random people walking around, and you were on your way to the docks in Amache to find a boat to take you to Rhavia.
Mm-hmm.
So you needed to cross the sand ocean area, the sand sea, and you needed to get a boat, and you needed to go to Rhavia so that you can meet the two Gagmi investigators who have something for you in your venture. And,
did we ever figure out who they were, or...
Nope, they didn't say their names.
Okay.
Do we know what they have, or is it just a surprise? Is it a surprise?
Believe they had. They didn't. Someone tell us they had Marv's Nagi. You said it. You said it was in your episode.
I don't think that it was said. Marv's Nagi. No, it is in your way. That's in the NPC interview.
Oh, damn it! I'm out of place. Sorry.
Did you just pull a spoiler? Piece of shit.
Yeah.
We'll
edit that in post. For our Patreon fans.
And we'll delete that in post.
Damn it, spoilers.
Or just censor it, blatantly.
Did somebody say that they have?
Just cut in Nick saying redacted.
Yeah. Redacted. Redacted.
Removed by editor.
I'm just going to take all of the coughs that we're going to have throughout this entire session because of COVID.
Oh my god, you should save them all into one giant cough track.
I'm COVID free. Still get to have COVID. I don't know how you fuckers keep getting it. I'm safe. I don't know.
This is my first time.
I have the most human interaction maybe of all of us. Mike does. Somehow.
But Mike works at a hospital, to be fair. They disinfect everything.
Yeah, I work around a bunch of people, and I work with COVID, so.
Yeah. I just work with idiots. But that's fine.
That's fair.
I went to a giant fucking concert and walked away with COVID, so that's on me.
You put yourself in a crowd full of idiots. That's really the biggest mistake.
Yeah. All right, let's dive in.
Okay.
So you guys head out of Amache toward the docks in Amache. You head to the western side of the city because that is the direction of Rhavia, and that is where the docks go. Is there anything you want to do inside the actual city before you get on a boat?
I forget the details on Amache. Do they have a weapon shop?
Amache did not. No.
Convenient. No. All right, that's cool.
That's where we had the Battle of the Bards.
Yeah, that was where the Battle of the Bards was. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like a big festival hippie city.
Yeah. It's like the desert Woodstock.
Groovy, baby.
Yeah.
All right, cool. I'm good with just going to the dock and grabbing a boat.
Maybe there's nothing here to shop for.
I mean, I'm pretty sure we stocked up in the last time we were in.
Probably.
In the Blinding Bay before we took off to Miskatonic U.
Yeah, I think I would be interested in would be herbs or darts. I don't think there's a lot of herbs in the desert, and I don't have any weapons, so I'm over it.
All right. So you guys get to the docks and you see that there are a ton of boats, but none of them are really prepping to ship out. And it looks like there's a ton of people trying to get on or get off the boats. But a lot of them are haggling with the boat workers and the dock workers right now as you arrive.
Can we overhear any kind of conversations and get a gist of what's going on?
Yeah, make a perception check. Or an investigation, depending on which is better.
Probably perception. Oh, never mind, I got a fucking three.
Oh, shit. I should probably do a check, too.
Jeez. 20 numbers on the dice, I roll a one.
I rolled a nine.
A nine?
We have sand in our eyes.
Perception, 21.
Okay. So, Ingvald, you hear as you're walking around that it sounds like a lot of the passengers are fighting with the crew about their belongings. It sounds like a lot of these are survivors from the city of Kos. And the cosplay was attacked by
us?
An otherworldly creature, like a old ones, you know, giant squid monster attacked the city.
Fuck yeah, Cthulhu's at it again. Stop that.
And these people were the refugees, and they took shipment, or they took boats to escape the city and head someplace safe. And these captains of these boats and these crews and stuff charged them exorbitant amounts of money. Of gold for their travels, and now it looks like some of these passengers can't pay. So the captain and the
price gougers,
the captain and the crew are keeping their belongings until they can pay for their passage to be given back. So sounds like there's a lot of back and forth going on.
Heard. So we have to do the good thing and get back these people's items.
So. Do we want to get involved with that, or do we want to just find a boat?
Well, if we get involved well enough, we take a boat. All right, fine. Maybe not that one. met with a very dry reaction. I would say morally that we probably need to get these people's things back because they're refugees because we're assholes and haven't sealed up a hole and we're letting Cthulhu-esque monsters out into the world. But also, I just brew beer. It's not my quest is to kill people.
I want to approach one of the captains that seems to be in the heat of the conversations. Ingvald, did you tell us what you overheard?
Oh yeah. Sorry. These captains are being absolute cunts. No, we can't use the word cunts, can we?
Oh, yeah. Makes sense.
Am I allowed to?
Have you heard our show?
That's fair. I forget what I can and can't say on the show.
Yeah. You just can't use cunt and Disney in the same sentence.
Ooh, we're gonna get sued!
They're holding their passengers... they're holding their passengers' items hostage all over a dispute of money after saving people.
So, I will go to...
I say we stab them.
Go to one of the captains. Excuse me, sir. What seems to be the problem here?
No problem at all. Just waiting for payment for services rendered from these folk. He motions to the ragtag people.
How much are you charging them?
Well, for the entire trip, 125 gold apiece.
Does that seem like a normal fare?
No, that's really expensive.
120, huh? And these are refugees, and you are taking advantage of these people like that?
I mean, supply and demand. It's not my fault the market shows that this is the going rate for a travel from the cosplay to Amache.
I would disagree with your ethics. I think you should reconsider allowing these people getting their belongings. They've been through enough, and they don't need more hassle from you.
And who are you to demand what I set my rates at?
I am Malphaedor Bromroyo of the Trade Guild Bromroyo.
The guy freezes up real quick, and go ahead and make an intimidation roll.
Oh, nice. That's 10.
Yay.
27.
Holy shit.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So he says...
He shits himself.
Yes.
Oh.
There you go. There's a stink on the dock.
I do business with your family. Hmm. Most of the stuff we transport is from the Bromroyo house. Yeah, I wouldn't want this to look unfavorably on our relationship, so,
very good.
Yeah, I think we could do well by these people and cut them loose.
Thank you. I'll make a note of your generosity and kindness to my family.
He turns to one of his crew members and he says, well, you heard what I said. You heard the man. Go get their possessions. They're free to go. And all of the civilians and refugees are like, oh, thank you so much. You are so kind. I appreciate it.
Oh, it's nothing. I don't want to see innocent people taken advantage of like this. Hurts my heart.
If there's anything we can do, I mean, we'll definitely be sure to shop the wares of the Bromroyo family.
Well, thank you. And I'll turn to the captain again. So, how soon can you be ready to sail out?
Oh, our ship is going to take a couple days at best. We got to give the hull a blowjob to get the sand out of there, so...
Yeah, fucking pardon me.
We get a lot of sand up in our underneath us, and we gotta blow it out so that we can sail across the sand sea again. There are a few boats that are around here that are smaller that might be ready to go, though.
I just thought it'd be nice if we could offer you a opportunity to make amends for your actions here today.
Where are you going?
To Rhavia.
Yeah, unfortunately, we're not going back that way. Not after we heard what's going on over there.
Okay. So perhaps you could direct us and recommend us to one of your colleagues that would be amenable to taking us.
Yeah, there's actually a boat. They didn't have passengers and stuff on their ship, and they're a smaller vessel, so they should be ready to go if you're ready to go. Just about four boats down, you see that smaller boat right there? The captain's name is Juan.
Juan?
Wait a minute!
God damn it!
Juan Fuke Lizard?
No.
Oh, okay, then I'm a little less angry. It's cool.
Okay.
It's about to be readily fucking annoyed.
Maybe a cousin. Okay.
Solid name for Juan.
So I'll turn back to the guys. Sound good?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, let's make a go for the boat. And I'll cast a glance back at the captain. He says, I'll remember this, and I'll remember you.
Yeah. I look forward to doing business with your family again soon. Have a safe journey.
Now, go change your shorts.
Quick question, Mal.
You smell.
What was the captain's name?
Yeah, what was the captain's name?
Yeah, we turn back. Who the fuck him. Are you?
Yeah.
I'll remember you.
Yeah.
Who the fuck is that guy?
I remember you. Who are you?
I wasn't
you
that
again?
Concerned about doing business with him. So. Yeah. I just remember. There's some asshole in Amache that. Oh, captain, yeah, he's a real douche.
So you walk along the docks and you come up to the boat, and you notice on the side of the boat, the name of the ship is the Centurion Emu, and there is a furbog sitting up on the ramp, just sitting there watching the events going on. He's got some crates behind him that he's leaning against, but... But yeah.
Cool.
Do you get it?
No, I'm trying right. so hard.
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
We'll wait.
Centurion Emu.
Centurion Emu. Is it like a Chocobo reference? I
don't know if No, that's a Millennium Falcon reference.
Yep.
I thought that was too odd. Okay.
The Centurion.
Because it's on land, so yeah. Emus can't fly. They just run on the ground.
That makes sense. Yeah. I got it.
So
it's not...
approach the Firbolg. So my friends and I are seeking passage if you're headed to Rhavia.
What, Juan Dos or something? What is this going to be?
He just grunts at you and points back toward the ship, and then a human man pops his head up and says... Hey, don't, you don't need to talk to Crunchy. He's fine. All right, I'm up here. I'm the captain of this vessel. Crunchy.
Juan Duet, I presume.
It's Juan Yolo.
Juan Yolo.
Oh, Juan Yolo.
There you go. Juan Yolo and Crunchy.
Juan Duet would have been good.
All right.
Crunchy, move those crates inside. Hurry up. We got to get out of here. What can I help you guys with?
We're seeking passage to Rhavia.
Rhavia? No one's going to Rhavia.
We are.
Huh?
And we'll pay well.
How well?
What's your standard rate?
Typically we bring people with us where we're going if they pay, 50 gold a person, but that's generally if we're going somewhere already. You're asking us to go out of our way, so, I don't know, maybe 100 gold?
Done.
Oh, shit, that worked. Chewy. Or not Chewy.
Crunchy.
Crunchy.
Fire up the engines.
let's get going. So Crunchy starts carrying the crates up and...
Yes. And let's just say we don't want any imperial entanglements. All right.
So you guys go in. It's a smaller ship, like I said. There's a weird board game kind of in the middle of the, main seating area. There's a harpoon gun up on one side of the ship, which is, small harpoon gun there. But it looks like it can hold its own out on the sand desert.
Cool.
And the two of them start getting a whole bunch of stuff around and move stuff so you can sit in the chairs. They had just stuff stacked in the seats and... Like, hurry up, get in. Yeah.
Cool.
And,
curious about the little chess set. Is that anything like Dragon Chess?
It is Dragon Chess, yeah. Awesome. A little bit more advanced. It's like a dual layer. It's like a multi-layer Dragon Chess. But you get the gist of it, being able to play three dimensions. Yeah.
Sweet. Should I let the Firbolg win?
I mean, if you don't, he might tear your arms off and beat you.
Laugh it up, fuzzball.
Sounds good. Sounds good.
All right. So you guys set sail. And you're heading out. And go ahead. Something's going to happen while you're sailing. But for after you land, go ahead and make your travel checks. I want to see what we have going on here. Remember, 18,
19,
or
20? 18.
Oh!
Dun, dun, dun.
14. I'm not in.
I got a 5.
Last travel event of the game.
Thank you so much for listening. We need to take a quick moment to flip it on over to the B-side, so sit tight and relax. A Fool's Quest will be right back.
After the mysterious death of his father, Vartan returns home to uncover the truth with the help of his newfound friends, Baya and Ovik. But his hometown of Eternal may have something even more sinister in store for them. Join us for their journey into the untold at etherealembracepodcast.com or anywhere you listen to podcasts by searching for Ethereal Embrace.
Microphones and Monsters is a Cthulhu D&D actual play with a balance of horror, mystery, and comedy. Our story begins in a 1920s Magitek noir setting. We follow the story of Alistair.
That power is very much something that I need, and I don't want that to stop.
Victor.
I don't think I want to help you.
And Julian.
It's burning. What happened here can't see the light of day.
As they come face to face with Eldritch horrors.
I don't think you could ever stop me.
And try not to fall into madness. Go to microphonesandmonsters.com or listen wherever podcasts are found.
Oh yeah, the flip side is spinning and the villains are chilling. Let's get back into it on a fool's quest. Now, let's join the drow rogue Ayda, the gladiator bard Francis the Lion, and the rogue warlock Hesh von Eggars as they conspire together to thwart the progress of those gagmy fools. Beware, there be villains here.
At that point, I'm going to swing my bagpipes around. And I'm going to start in with just some eerie drone.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And just strike a pose. About 15 feet behind him.
I'll keep walking towards the generals. Okay. The adventurers that were following you, the Gagmi adventurers.
Oh, shit, I forgot about that.
hungry and,
Starving and Geraldo.
Yeah, starving and Geraldo. They hop around the corner, and walk up behind Ayda and, whisper to you, Ayda.
What did we miss?
Oh, just watch the show. I'll tell you in a little bit.
Okay.
It is like popcorn, like pulling popcorn out. She's like sets her short bow down and has popcorn.
Francis like, pulls out a box of notebooks.
I'm about to get full custody.
Excellent. Yes.
If Hesh dies, what are we gonna do with him? He's just gonna exist. You're familiar just always exists now. Okay, so you see one of the generals, he's got like all this patches and stuff on his armor. It's really like flare that he's wearing. So one's like, you know, it's nice to orc you. And
people, it's what's for dinner.
Yeah. 9 out of 9 star performance, and it's just got a hellfire under it. Yeah. All right, so he starts walking toward you, and he's got more flair than anyone else. All right, and he starts walking up, and he says,
"Are you adventurers here to challenge us?"
And the horde starts to like come back around to.
He says it in common.
Yeah, in common. Yep. Oh. It's like a gargled common.
All right.
Well, damn it! And he like Hesh turns back like a quarter turn back and goes, "Well, damn it." And then turns back over and goes, the Francis the Lion has come to challenge your greatest and mightiest champion in single combat, if you're brave enough."
He shouts at you,
"Are you the one that was foretold? Are you the one that has fallen from grace to be reborn?"
"Yeah, that's me."
"Yep, that's him."
"And if you're not afraid, then take up the challenge."
All right, you do hear him say something to one of his lieutenants in Abyssal, or Infernal. And he says, he's like,
"I thought he would have wings. Isn't he supposed to have wings?"
Message back with awakened mind and whisper kind of under my breath, and like,
"He wanted you to have wings. I don't know if you can do anything about that."
"Don't."
Hold on.
Disguise kit really quick.
I'm gonna cast prestidigitation and just make a little shower of feathers.
"Behold!
Best I got."
"There's some stuff. Listen, terms and conditions. If he wins, you let us pass No harm, no foul. You can have the town or what have you, the port, but you leave us and ours and the ship alone. And then answer any questions we may have. If he loses and your champion wins, he'll go live in your little suburb or wherever it is you came from.
He says,
counter proposal.
Oh, nice word.
Thank you. If he wins, I die.
True.
If I win, you all die.
Debatable.
Wait. So, if I win, then only one of you has to die, but if you win, all of us have to die? That doesn't seem very fair.
True.
It's not a very equitable term.
But if you win, you rule the host.
Oh, okay, that's fair.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Yep.
That's acceptable.
Hesh gets out of the way.
I didn't hear any of that.
You did hear that. And Ayda, it would kind of click with you with your really good role earlier as well. Zariel is huge into combat. Like, war heavy. Like, that is her vibe. Like, so to raise up in the ranks is probably completely based off combat skill for her. So that would track for you. And them putting the rules into play and not being sneaky about it also would track for that.
Are they within shouting distance?
Yeah, they can. Yep, they are.
Hesh, you are so fucked. Stop talking.
I'm not doing anything.
You're negotiating with them.
I'm all done. My job's
We're not
been
saying
done.
All this. We're not saying all this. I'm just saying, Hesh, you're fucked.
The Gagni guys take a couple steps back after hearing that they have to die too.
Hesh absolutely says that as he's walking back. I didn't do anything wrong. I'm all done.
It wasn't me.
Yeah, listen, my job was completed. 10 out of 10.
Back to that popcorn. I am really munching that. I'm asking for refills.
All right, so the orcs begin bashing their weapons, like the hilts of their swords and the tips of the spears and stuff, on their armor to make a loud, like, chun, chun, chun noise as the leader starts to prep himself and get ready to go into the middle of this ring that they seem to be creating.
All right, I'm going to cast Mislead, which makes me invisible and creates an illusory devil in the same spot. And then I'm going to walk with that devil to the ring, and then I'm going to have it stand, you know, off to the side of me.
Okay. All right. So how far away are you from this devil?
So 10 feet.
Okay. And what is your illusory devil doing?
He's just standing there looking kind of bored.
Okay.
Twirling the rod of lordly might.
All right. Well, I guess this is probably a good time to roll initiative. That little imp comes and stands next to you, Hesh. He's like, but he's like outside of arm's length, so you can't hit him with a newspaper again. Oh, shit. This is
the story of a girl.
A 21 for the orc leader.
16.
Can I roll as well just to see, like, if shit goes sideways?
Yeah. You guys can dive into it. That's probably good. An initiative. You should roll two, Ayda, just in case you want to do range stuff.
22.
Okay. Yep.
22.
Okay.
Oh, Sebastian. Do I roll? He's not as advantage, right?
I'll just let him go on your turn. Yeah. After you finish your stuff, you can go. So Ayda and S. And then
Orc.
The high orc. And then Hesh. And then Frank. Francis. Alright. Ayda, is there anything you want to do before they start fighting? They're like getting ramped up. They're all in a circle now.
Francis didn't do a religion check, so he doesn't know shit either.
Nope.
Do you?
No, you're the only one that really knows what's going on here.
So, if they allow, I want to, like, prep my fighter, give him a pep talk.
Okay.
And just be like, dude, you are so fucked. These are fighters
by nature. Like, that's all they do. This, yeah, they're good luck.
So you walk to up.
I got
to
your back.
Illusory double and say that, which is like, what, 10 feet away from Francis. Yeah. But Francis hears you nonetheless.
That's all for show because they're going to be looking at him.
Yeah.
I'm just going to go back to Carlos because I can't leave him unattended. Does he have any powers? Does he get to go?
Carlos does have powers, but I have not ever put them.
Keep that sweet boy out of combat.
Okay, good.
He's very
fragile.
If I
have to, I will chuck him.
He's got powers, but he is not.
If I have to, I'll just bonus action dismiss him and he'll be safe.
All right.
Bounce him in like a hacky sack.
So,
what the fuck?
Is Sebastian doing anything or just getting powered up on his armor?
I don't, you tell me. What's in that mech suit?
The mech suit... do one of you have the mech suit on here?
I did. So essentially it gives you a +5 to your AC. You reduce any incoming attacks by 2d6. And then it also gives you strength advantages as well. It started with 100 hit points and now it's down 69. To 69 hit points.
Sebastian's just gonna hang out until he's needed.
So they have made this ring. Is it like a ring of them? Like, are they standing in a circle to make the ring?
Yeah, so you guys were in, like I said, like a market...
It's like Fight Club on the street.
Yeah, right. Like a market square type
make sure
area.
I was imagining it.
Yeah, okay. And they have made a ring like Fight Club style.
Nice. All right, so he's first, huh?
Yeah.
Yep. So, Ayda, real quick, I'm going to send you... I just took a screenshot of that, I think, of that mech suit, so you can see what's on it.
Eventually, I could add that into my inventory.
You can add it in right now if you want. Yeah, on D&D Beyond. It's in there. It's just called Mech Suit. But all right, there you go. Okay, so he sees an opening, and he shouts on his own and then charges forward right at your illusory double, and he has a... an enormous great axe, and he draws it while he's charging forward and takes the great axe and swings it at your illusory double. Okay, alright, so it goes right through, and let's see if he makes a dexterity save to catch his balance, because he was anticipating it landing and hitting something. Oh, that is a 14. So I think that should be good enough to keep his footing. But he does kind of lose off his balance and stumbles a couple steps forward toward the edge of the ring. Away from you.
How big is the ring?
The ring is about 60 feet in diameter.
Oh, beautiful. And about how far from the nearest edge is he currently?
About 10 feet.
Oh, that's beautiful. All right. I'm going to Francis the Lion this, and he's also about 10 feet from me, right?
Yeah, yep.
I am going to drop the invisibility, because I'm pretty sure that's concentration, isn't it? Maybe not. Either way, it'll go away when I attack, because that's what I'm going to do. Yeah, I'm going to activate the Rod of Gorgly Might as a flaming rapier. And stab that dude. No, I'm not. That's a 1. And then I'm going to attack him with my second attack. 18.
That one hits.
I am going to use my Gift of the Chromatic Dragon and infuse that with lightning as a bonus action as well. Yeah, 18 damage. And then I am going to move 40 feet away from him.
All right. And I think we skipped Hesh's turn. So... Hesh, what are you doing?
Oh, shit, my bad.
It's cool. I was just watching the magic of him catching his balance. I am going to... So I rolled stealth for this, because I figured that'd probably be a smart thing to do. 20 stealth for me to cast a spell.
Okay.
Am I within 30 feet of the duder?
I mean, you could move to a spot in the ring where you could. Yeah.
And I'm going to cast suggestion on him.
Okay.
DC wisdom save of 17.
Okay, so no one saw you, and that's a nat 20 to save on suggestion.
Humiliation.
So nobody saw you cast, though. Rolled shitty for that. Which actually, wisdom saves is it's plus 2, so 22 to save.
Alright, sounds good. And then he puts his hands back into his like holding his hands in front of his person, like nothing ever happened.
All right.
Where's this go?
Mumble out a spell.
All right,
and Ayda, it is you and Sebastian.
Still nothing. Francis is doing all right.
Okay.
So far. So
just hanging out, waiting.
As soon as he gets hit, though.
All right. So that means it is the orc's turn. And the orc grabs an enormous spear off his back and he chucks it at Francis. Plus 11 to hit.
Oh, damn.
So that is a 19 to hit.
That'll do.
Alright. So he chucks it at you and it is 17 damage. So he chucks it at you and it hits you. And it's like an enormous spear. This guy is he's a big, big boy. So he takes this spear off his back and just chucks it at you from across the ring. And it just plugs right into your body. And yeah, now you have a giant spear in you.
The glare.
And he... his movement is 60. That's not true. No. His movement is 40, though.
Oh, he's as fast as I.
Yep. So he does charge forward, but he, as he's charging forward, that was his attack for this round. And he doesn't have a spear anymore. So that means it is Hash's turn.
So I got a nat 20 on stealth, which is 24, I believe. And I'm going to cast Phantasmal Force on him. The craft's an illusion, so I need Intelligence 17 saving throw.
That is a 12, sir.
Alrighty. So it's going to craft an illusion that takes root in the mind of the creature. I am going to craft the illusion of the fluffiest, like, Pinkie Pie-esque pony slash, like, unicorn. Like, if Pinkie Pie was a unicorn and it was just, like the bunny from, Monty Python's Holy Grail. So, like, it pops up right in front of him. And it bounces in the air toward him, and then just bares its teeth and they're razor sharp and blood filled, and then starts like trying to, bite him and mess with him and essentially getting all up in his face, just in like his shoulders and face area, like that whole 10-foot area of his upper torso. It's going to just be radiating him. And then it multiplies, so there's like many of them, in this little area.
So that's what he's going to do. Imagining, and he takes damage.
5 damage.
Okay.
Psychic.
Okay.
And Hesh is just sitting there with like a piece of fleece, just like it's a safety blanket, because that's what it took to cast it.
Does this one have any of those tattoos or brands, like the scars?
Yep. It's got the Zariel. The Zariel.
Oh, that's right.
Tattoo.
I couldn't dispel that.
Watch for that. I just spelled Ariel with a Z.
Instead, I'm going to cast Eye Bite.
Okay.
I need a wisdom save for that.
That is a 14.
He is now frightened of me, and on each of his turns, the frightened creature must take the dash action and move away from me by the fastest and shortest available route unless there is nowhere to move. Target moves to a place at least 60 feet away from you where it can no longer see you. This effect ends.
Okay.
Yep. And, yeah, that's my action.
So I don't think Francis would know that I cast anything on either. You'd just be fighting this guy, and then...
Yeah. It's in his head, right?
Yeah, it's only in his head. Yeah. He's tripping balls right now.
Mm-hmm.
Pinkie Pie is just... There's, like, a multitude of tiny Pinkie Pies with horns and teeth. And tearing at this guy.
That's what you get. All right, it is Ada's turn.
Do these guys, like, blow up like the other ones do if we dispel magic on them?
We haven't tried it yet.
Is there a range to that?
Yes.
What is the range?
I believe 30 feet. I could be wrong.
Well, I'm kind of pissed because he hit Francis. Francis has been stabbed with a spear. Like, I warned you, buddy.
Oh, I'm fine.
Tis but a scratch.
Spell magic is 120 feet.
How many other of these orcs are around?
Yeah, there's about 40 around this circle, but more and more keep coming. The runners that were running out and then coming back to the people in charge, they keep, you know, groups of three or four keep appearing. So that number keeps growing and growing until the market is filling up with orcs.
Evil demon orcs.
Does there appear to be like a hierarchy or just that guy?
There is a hierarchy, so that guy, I mean, he's like a big orc, but there's also like little demon imps that are there. There's like little demon, I mean, the imps kind of are the smallest of the groups, and they're the ones out terrorizing, doing stuff. There's maybe 30 orcs total in this whole unit, so you maybe see 10 orcs at this point, 10 hellfire orcs.
Yeah, I guess. I'll just hang back, let him continue to do his thing, and, like, kind of shout out, like, watch your back, bro. Like, give him a, like, we're here. Give us a sign when you're in trouble.
An Ayda inspiration.
Yeah, I'll let him be.
1d4 of hope.
Sebastian might be getting worried, though.
So I've just realized that at this point, unless he can hold up for 10 rounds... He can't attack me anymore. At all. So all I have to do is stand, you know, near the middle. Pull him in with Pulse Wave. He'll run away, but he'll be close enough that I'll catch up and stab him. Or I could just keep chasing him and stabbing him, but he can dash, so he can go further in the diameter 60 feet. So I'll just, you know, pull him in with the Pulse Wave a couple of times, stab him after that, maybe...
So to speed this along, should you do 10 attacks? Are we just going to rinse and repeat until the eye bite runs out?
Yeah, you want to do that?
Yeah, because we can narratively talk through what that damage looks like, but roll it up real quick to give us 10 attacks worth of damage. Because even if you attack him, he's just going to run away, right?
Yeah.
It doesn't break the eye bite?
Right.
So it's this not is at the start or at the end of his turn, and if he takes damage, he doesn't.
Five rounds worth of d20s. And the crit did 25.
Okay.
Oh, wait. I'm doing 10 rounds of d6 damage, too.
From the mind spike? How long does that last for 10 rounds?
A minute.
A minute? So you actually have 9 because you already did 1.
Okay. I mean, 3 more of them just did... 56 damage.
28 plus 56. Okay.
He's still up.
Oh, yeah.
26. 32, 33 damage.
So plus 33.
Another 53.
Okay, that'll do it. He had 160 to start.
Yeah. Yeah, for my last one, I'm gonna pause. I'm going to turn and look at the crowd and say, this is something I've been working on. I call it my finishing move, and I'm going to shout magic missile. Then I'm going to kick him in the dick.
All right. Yeah. So as the 1 minute goes on, right? All of the imps were screaming, and the other demonoid creatures were screaming, and the hellish orcs were screaming at first. And as he's just running around, he drew his great sword too, his enormous sword too. So he's got his enormous great axe, his enormous sword. He's swinging at something imaginary in the sky above his head, running, dashing away from you as fast as he can. And at this point, he's doing full attacks with his weapons, because at 50% health, he can do 3 attacks with his enormous weapons. So he's swinging at things all around his head, trying to fucking kill this, running away from you while you're stabbing him over and over and over again.
Slashing.
The crowd goes silent. Like, all of these creatures that value combat more than anything are completely still. So when you make that remark about magic missile, it's deadly quiet. And then you kick him in the balls, and he collapses to the ground, spits out blood, and dies.
Yep.
And all of the imps and lesser demons turn their attention toward the group of lieutenants, and the group of lieutenants fall down to one knee.
Hesh will come out from the rings and say, "Behold, your leader, the immaculate, amazing Francis the Lion."
I don't know about immaculate. I mean, I've got the spear hole, but
you do have
amazing
a spear
is
hole.
Accurate.
Majestic. He says afterward.
As majestic as my namesake, the Great Lion.
Francis the Victorious.
I'm gonna point at the, you know, just vaguely gesture towards them and the group of lieutenants there on one knee and say something like, "You schmucks speak common?"
"Yes, we do."
"All right, good. You're..."
Oh my god.
"You're my right hand man."
"I'm a female named Tiffany."
"You heard what I said."
"Okay."
"Tiffany, walk with me."
Only right handed.
Tiffany stands to walk with you.
Toss an arm around her shoulder. "I need to know why your, what did he call it? The horde? The host? Whatever. This, your gathering here is, well, here. Why are you here?"
"We have come to secure this plane of existence from the greater evil."
"The greater evil. You came from the greater evil, or are you securing it from the greater evil?"
"We're securing it from the greater evil."
"Which makes you the lesser evil, then?"
"Yes."
"That's pathetic. What's this greater evil?"
Oh, the Forgotten God. He's coming back."
"That sounds foreboding, and also kind of what Duche was looking to do, isn't it?"
Hesh is looting the body.
Okay. Ayda, you noticed that the crowd size... The orcs that have been, one of them let out like a big cry, and all of the other orcs seem to have come back in. Not just orcs, but the other demons and stuff as well. And you notice an army of maybe 200?
"Well, listen, Tiffany. Maybe you didn't notice, but I live here, so this place is already pretty secure. I'm going to need you and my... horde, host, what was the word he used? It doesn't matter. This group, you need to take them back where you came from."
Malish.
"Oh, yes."
Just like holding the great, like awkwardly holding both of the giant weapons. Like walking up. Some other shit that I pulled off of him, we'll get to later. And be like, Is it wise to send a valuable resource back when we could be utilizing it?"
"Yes, but what do we need an army that's in this place for? And we don't have a way to move them, really."
"What couldn't you do with an army?"
"I mean, one that's in the middle of the sand sea."
"All right. Before we make any..."
"What do you call it?" "I mean, not that I don't like it."
"Your holiness." Because you got a spear in your side.
You know what I mean?
Because you got
the hole.
Before we make any decisions, should we talk over pros and cons of what you would like to do?
I mean,
or would you like to send them back?
It doesn't really matter to me. I just wanted them out of my hair. But if you've got plans for them, then...
You do also note that there were otherworldly things, like the giant Cthulhu-esque monster that came out and wrecked the cosplay. So there are other realms that are sending armies to.
Oh, yeah. So, Tiffany.
Yeah?
Who sent you to guard against the greater evil?
Zariel.
That's what Ayda said.
Zariel.
Yes.
The demon lord Zariel, ruler of one of those hells.
Devils? Yes, goddess. Archdevil.
Whatever she is.
It's a nice lady.
Why? What danger does this forgotten god, or whatever you called it, pose?
I'm sorry, my liege. I thought you already had these details from your conversation with Zariel. Yeah, the Elder Gods are coming. You're trying to establish a foothold. We're here to help you secure it.
Yeah, it was in the pamphlet, my liege. I'm sorry, I forgot to give it to you. That's my fault.
Yeah. Sorry to find good help these days.
All right.
It's the third one this month.
We'll talk about this later.
This concludes this episode of A Fool's Quest. Join us next time for more fun and daring adventure. Thank you for listening, and don't forget to like, subscribe, review, and comment on your favorite platform to listen to A Fool's Quest.